Coolerbot, are you almost here with the shuttle? We gotta get the hell out of here.
We're in the pipe, 5x5.
Okay, cool. Whatever that means.
Man, what was up with those weird, like, tube worm things?
Which ones? The ones without the teeth or the ones with the teeth?
I mean, both of them suck, so either?
Prepare for some chop.
Okay, Coolerbot, just get down here, man. This place is weird, and everyone is dead, and the insides of all of these structures look like wasps' nests or something.
Where's the damn beacon?
There's no beacon, Coolerbot. Just land in the giant field.
Coming around for a 709er.
Welcome to Crew Expendable. I am Beast as Black as Sin, Hallstrom.
And I'm Sergeant Major Rohrbacher.
And we're just a couple of tube worm things burrowing our way through the alien universe.
Yeah, I never really knew what to call those things, so I was just calling them tuber xenos in my notes, because, yeah. Spoiler alert, listeners, those things are called tubers.
Yeah, the base creature is called, like, a tuber, right? And they only live in caves, right? So, okay.
They sure do.
And we're just a couple of tubers living in the caves of the alien franchise. That's better. I like it.
Either one's fine, and frankly, you can leave them both in.
Gonna leave them both in. That's how we do here, man. We strive for that natural conversational dialogue that made Aliens such a memorable film.
You know it, baby.
When you try to force it, then you get stuff like Alien Resurrection. But we're not there yet.
We're about to be, though.
We're getting fucking close. But for now, we are talking Marvel's Alien Revival Part 2, issues 10, 11, and 12 of Alien Volume 1, the final three issues of this revival storyline. Written by Philip Kennedy Johnson, with art by Salvador LaRocca, colors by Guru EFX, letters by VCs Clayton Cowles, and covers by Mark Aspinall.
Indeed.
Yeah. Now, we were pretty high on part one of this story arc, Kenny. I just want to get a vibe check up front. How do you feel about this second half of it?
I thought it was pretty good. I think of the, I was going to say of the three arcs we read, but like of the three arcs of like volume one that we read, I think this one, the closest to stuck the landing of the three of them.
Oh, you think so? Okay.
I do. And I like you said, we were both pretty high on it. I liked the first three issues, so I was going into this looking forward to seeing where it goes, and it did do some things I didn't expect, and so I was kind of like pleasantly surprised at some of the things that happened in this one.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Still some surprises to be had. I liked this overall. I do lean towards that first half being stronger than the second half, but maybe
I think I like the first half more too. That's true. Yeah.
And if we're comparing this to the other Philip Kennedy Johnson story arcs, I think I'm still laying this right in the middle of the three with Icarus on top, then this, but it's a little closer than I remember it being, honestly.
Yeah.
And then there's a pretty wide gap though between this and Bloodlines.
Also for sure.
And I'm shoving the annual in with Bloodlines. It's a very much of the same vein.
That's fine. So I'll allow that.
The Gabriel Cruz saga. Why wasn't the annual about these people?
Couldn't tell you. I'm not the writer, so I don't know why he decided to do that.
Somebody get Philip Kennedy Johnson on the line. You want to just do we want to do a brief recap? I think we can recap issues one the first half of this pretty basically, right?
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to go for it if you don't mind, unless you have something prepared.
I do not mind. Go ahead.
Okay. So part one of this story arc, we find the Spinners, a religious group called the Spinners, are setting up a terraforming operation for the United Americas on a moon called Euridice. And in exchange for setting up these atmosphere processors, it's been taking something like 20 years or something like that to get the moon terraformed properly.
Correct. Yes. Yeah.
And in exchange for terraforming this moon, which gives the United Americas access to not a trimonite mine.
It was a neodymium mine.
A neo, Politan mine.
I'll allow it.
The spinners, who are like an anti-technology, anti-industry sort of religious sect, will get to have this planet as like a paradise, and all they have to do is sort of maintain these facilities on occasion, I guess. So like a lot of technology use for these people who have rejected technology, but I guess they were getting persecuted and things, you know, on other worlds. So this is a nice paradise for them. Time for the shutdown comes, and they do shut the atmosphere processors down, and everything is good. So they're waiting for the ship to come in with the lawyers to sign over the planet to them and all of the other spinners who are coming to live there. And that ship crashes, and xenomorphs get out. We're going to shortcut it. A bunch of xenomorphs get out. Nobody believes Jane at first, especially this guy Ambrose, who's like her second in command. But then we find out that Ambrose was a company plant and a synthetic who knew that the aliens were coming. So Jane, Simon, who was one of the guys running the atmosphere processor, who's got a crush on somebody at another one of the atmosphere processor villages. Leo, who is the guy who hacked Ambrose's brain. Tabby, or Tabitha, who is Gunner's partner. Ambrose's head, and an old guy whose name I don't remember, so in my notes I wrote Old Man River. I'll leave the village and cut the rope bridge as the xenomorphs descend on the rest of the religious fanatics who refuse to leave, insisting that Mother would save them. Also, Mother is absolutely a reference to the goddess. That's good enough, right?
I believe at the end of issue 5, we're told that old guy's name is Bowie.
Bowie?
But I think it's only ever mentioned once ever in the entire comic.
Okay. Bowie. Like David Bowie.
Yes.
Oh, you think it's a reference? Like David from Prometheus? And all right.
I do not know.
Probably not. Probably coincidence, right? Feels like
probably.
The kind of thing that would be coincidence. All right. That's a pretty good summation of the first half of the story arc. Honestly, you should go read it. It's pretty good.
I liked it.
Yeah. So now we're picking up several weeks later in issue 10. As the 5 survivors are creeping through the forest jungle, I don't know what to call this thing.
Right? I just noticed it. I notated it as a forest, but it doesn't really matter, honestly.
Yeah, it's an alien landscape, right? It's alien topography, so you know, who knows the classification. But they're headed from Site A, or Alpha Site, which was their site, to Beta Site. Mm-hmm. To Beta Station, right? Hoping that there's survivors there, hoping that the aliens didn't get that far. They encounter one of these tubers, which are, I don't know how to describe these things. They kind of look like, I don't know what they look like. What do they look like?
They're weird little fucked up moles, kind of.
There they are. Yeah, they're like skinless, weird little fucked up moles called tubers.
And yeah, they're called tubers, and we're told that they exclusively only live in caves. So the fact that they're like seen out in the woods is considered to be extremely weird. And listeners, I'll give you 3 guesses to figure out why these tubers are no longer living in the caves.
Predators.
Well,
no, Terminators.
Well, remember, Predator is a specific thing, right, with a precise meaning on this show.
From the movie. Terminators. That's my second guess. Am I right so far?
That's correct. There's a whole bunch of Terminators living in the caves on this planet. That's
stupid
correct.
Of me. It's caves, right?
Yes.
Klindathu from Starship Troopers. That's in there.
That's precisely what's in there. Yes. While they stop and have this discussion about tubers, Jane tells everyone that she had gotten rid of Ambrose's head several weeks prior. And then when she goes out to go scout ahead, we immediately discover that, in fact, she does still have it.
Yeah.
And I bet, people are going to find out that she still has it and then get mad at her later on. I believe I'm guessing, like I wrote in my notes, I'm guessing that's going to be a plot point later.
And it's not going to take very long either.
It does not. They find out before the end of this issue.
There was no, they find it like in 2 pages. Like, I don't understand why she, because first of all, that relies, like we have to believe that Ambrose was like, cool and being quiet and not trying to fuck things up for her, right? She's like, I threw him away. He could have just been like, no, she didn't. I'm in her bag, right? Because that's what he does. He just talks in front of them later and they're like, holy shit, you still have Ambrose, right? I don't know, silly, whatever, right?
They finally eventually make it to Beta Station, and when they get there, it is precisely as fucked up as Alpha was when they left Alpha Station.
Possibly more and fucked up. There's like possibly blood splattered more in the streets and everything here. It's wild.
And Simon immediately insists on going in and looking for Sophie. And when they do start looking for survivors, there's several panels of them just quoting scripture to each other for a little while.
Yeah.
And then there's this little side note where Leo suddenly becomes like self-aware of his situation and starts telling the story about this this like book or article, yeah, or something that he remembers reading about this religion in Asia that was really popular
in the 21st century.
And it was founded by like this blind guy. And then actually, as it turns out, the religion was actually effectively founded by the government to try to get the people to do what they wanted them to do. And he makes a point of even saying the guy wasn't even actually blind.
Yeah, I don't think this is a true story.
I was not able to find any evidence online that there was a real actual religion that this happened. So I don't think it's real, but I mean, I also didn't do very much research about it. So maybe it is, and I just missed something. I don't know.
I don't know, man.
I thought this was just a weird little aside, but the reason I'm mentioning it is because this does come up later in the book.
Yeah, I mean, we can spoil that here, honestly. It comes in directly in relation, like they're questioning, like, do you think the spinners, do you think we were just set up, yeah, right? Were we set up by the company or by the government or something? Was the spinner belief system made up? Which I think it was, honestly, personally.
We're never given a definitive answer either way. So whether it is or not is entirely up to however the reader feels about it. So if you think it was, then for you, that means it was, baby.
There you go. It's like Inception, right?
It's exactly like Inception, yes.
I want to compliment the artwork here.
All right.
I don't think we focused on this I don't think we looked at this enough in issue in the first half of this. But there is something like fascinating about, I'm seeing it again on this approach when they're approaching beta station, right? And you've got this, like, these, you know, timber buildings that were built essentially like farms and farmhouses and things, just like looming like under the shadow of an atmosphere processor. And in this instance, you can see like the red trail leading into the mine, right? But there's this, I mean, we had shots like that in the first handful of issues of this big atmosphere processor, again, just hanging over like the chapel, right? As if it's just this force that looms over them all, you know, their whole lives. And mm-hmm. This is supposed to be a religious organization that has rejected technology, right? They live without it, completely without machines, you know. That's their lifestyle. Yet here they are, like, literally in the shadow of it. And the only way that they're able to exist out here is, like, is thanks to this atmosphere processor, you know. Fascinating. Like, it's cool images, right? And it's sort of, I mean, really tells the story of what the story is about as well.
I also had some thoughts about the art, and since we're already talking about it, I'll just mention them now.
Yeah.
Because there isn't anything that like needs to wait until later. I don't have the book open in front of me at the moment, so I can't really cite specific examples off the top of my head, but I do remember, when I was reading through these issues at first, not really noticing anything specific about the art, as far as nothing particularly jumped out to me as egregiously bad. So I'm forced to assume that means that I just, you know, thought the artwork was fine, bordering on good for the most part.
Yeah.
Although near the end of this group of issues, I did start coming across a few things that I did like actively think not looked that good.
Yeah, there's some stuff for sure. But again, there's also like, we're going to get some of these cool images later on too. I think, again, I do think the book kind of plays to maybe his strengths a little bit more, maybe just in terms of like he draws exteriors well and open areas well, right?
Yeah.
And it's when like I have some issues, like just two pages after the one that I was, the panel that I was just praising, where we're inside and we're just seeing all of these joists and rafters and things that are just, it, there's no rhyme or reason to the way they're drawn and the perspective is kind of wild and it's like, okay. But that's just me, you know, looking at the details of like the timber framing in this building and being like, I don't, that's not really how we do it. You know? So
there's a page coming up. I do actually remember it. There is a page coming up here soon where it is multiple horizontal panels stacked on top of each other in the page.
Yeah.
And like, two or three of the panels are literally just duplicate copy paste with one or two things changed between them.
Interesting. There's a lot of these stacked horizontal panels in this book. The layout, but the panel layout in this isn't doing it for me. Like I remember praising the panel layouts for Thaw and for Icarus. Mm-hmm. I'm not, these are pretty mid, to quote you, quoting the kids.
That's right.
All right. Let's keep going though.
But yeah, after that discussion about the religion, they find this, I don't know, like people mover APC tank kind of thing.
Right.
And they have a brief discussion that borders on an argument about whether to leave or not. And then to my eternal dismay, my boy Simon pulls a gun on them and then uses it to distract them enough to run into the mine because he is positive that Sophie is in there somewhere.
Yeah.
And everyone's like, oh, fuck. All right, let's go. And they all haul ass into the mine after him.
There's something grim I'm saying the page before that in, again, where I was making fun of the way the framing is drawn on one of these rafters on one of these trusses, we've got nooses hanging, right, that have been like broken as if like people were hanging themselves to like escape from these monsters, but then they were like ripped out of the nooses almost, which is a real grim thought, right?
What was the thing we just read? Was it Bloodlines or the annual, maybe? We just read something where they came across like that whole room full of bodies of people that killed themselves.
That was in Bloodlines.
Okay.
That was in Bloodlines? That was in Bloodlines.
I don't remember.
It was on, not Nishimura, on Epsilon Station, where, a whole bunch of people had just like gone in a room and killed themselves and written on the wall in blood, like, they're free now or they're safe now or something, or they had a bunch of them had hung themselves. Yeah. This seems to be an idea that Philip Kennedy Johnson and Salvador LaRocca like to revisit, because also in the next panel, we have this beast as black as sin graffiti written on the wall in blood as well. So a very similar scene of people trying to like mass execute themselves to not become Xenomorph fodder.
I did not notice that in this book, so I will take your word for it.
Yeah. And then there's a literal trail of blood leading to the mines. You're dissing our boy Simon, but Simon's like, he's like, look, there could be survivors in there. Yes, he is thinking about one particular person, Sophie, right? The girl he likes. But I think he's also just generally thinking about anyone. You know, because when he finds somebody alive, he doesn't even know if it's Sophie or not, and admits he doesn't know. He just gets them out.
Well, the reason he gets them out is because he convinces himself that that is Sophie, but we're not quite there yet.
Right. We're not quite there yet.
This is the point where the rest of the group discovers that Jane does still have Ambrose's head. So it takes about 2/3 of an issue to get to.
Despite the fact that as they were walking into this site, Ambrose is just monologuing from her bag and she's only about 10 feet in front of everybody else. Like, I feel like they would have heard the man, but whatever.
But she, I guess, turns the head on, maybe. I guess might be how like they don't like know that she still has it. Maybe it has like a power switch or something.
I think he's just being cool.
But she talks to it because he like has like the map data downloaded, so he's able to guide them through the mine into the hive. And then this is when Simon discovers a woman in the resin that he believes to be Sophie. He's like, "Sophie, is that you?" And she doesn't really say anything. And he's like, "Yeah, I bet you're probably Sophie. I'm just going to assume that you are," and then yanks her out.
Right. The people he finds in here, though, right, are bursted in weird. They're like missing arms and things.
Mm-hmm.
It's really weird looking.
And then he actually meets one particularly looking, a weird looking corpse.
Yeah.
That is a gigantic bloated corpse of a human.
Yeah.
That's like puffed out like it got inflated like a tire. And its mouth breaks open and a whole bunch of those tubers come out. But the tubers have been xenomorphized and a whole bunch of them leap out and attack him. And he pulls out the gun and starts firing on them. And the gunfire attracts the attention of like Jane and the rest of the group.
Yeah.
And so they're able to run in and save him just as a whole bunch of the tuber xenos are about to descend on him.
All right, go with me on this journey real quick.
Okay.
Yaphet Kotto from Alien plays Kananga in Live and Let Die.
He sure does.
And at the end, the way he meets his demise is he gets shot with, I think it's like a weapon used on sharks. Am I remembering that correctly in the movie?
I don't know. It's been years that since I've
seen it. Causes this human man to inflate like a balloon, float up to the ceiling and explode.
All right.
So I think this bloated corpse is a reference to Yaphet Kotto in Alien.
I just assumed it was a reference to the fact that this thing was stuffed full of miniature xenomorphs, but okay.
Also that, yeah, it is. And these things are fucking, I don't like these things, dude.
They're real gross. They're about to get a lot grosser too.
They're going
to
be somehow the podcast art.
As the whole group of them is fleeing from these tuber xenos,
yeah.
Jane's leg gives out, like, you know, the entire comic up to this point has been threatening that it would.
Right.
And Tabby stops to try to pick her up, and then a normal size xeno comes out of nowhere and just fucks up Tabby and real, like, bad, knocks her around. It looks like it even breaks her back.
It grabs her, it knocks her down, then it picks her up and like uses its weird, like, kind of joined fingers to open her mouth so that one of those tuber xenos can crawl inside it.
Well, sure, but like I was referencing, like, right before it, when it picks her up, she's bent in a strange way that looks like her spine is almost broken.
It could be. I just took it as bad artwork. But you're fair right. Enough. That could very well be, like, she could have been like, because there is a cut. You're right. There's a crack. Like,
yeah,
there's a big sound. So like, yeah,
and that might snapped. Just be that might just be it hitting her and knocking her down. But yeah. Like the way her body is drawn, right. Her back is bent at a strange angle. And I was right. Like, did it just break her spine? But anyway, that doesn't matter because it opens her mouth and one of yeah. the tubers jumps head first into her mouth and crawls into her body.
It's rough. And she's like, she's having this as she's down, right? She's saying, like, I'm afraid that my kids don't think about me anymore. They still think about me, don't they, Jane? Because I think the part of her backstory is she left her kids and her family to join the spinner colony, right?
Apparently.
I believe that was talked about in the first half. I'm not positive. But, and it might have just been a more general conversation about we have left our families and our people behind to do this, you know? Because if she was talking about her kids here, A, she wouldn't have left them behind, and B, they wouldn't be able to think about her. They'd be fucking dead. So, yeah,
but man. Surprise, that's how issue, well, you would call it issue 10, I guess, but yes. I have it as issue 4 in my notes.
Meanwhile,
that's yes. how that issue ends.
It is. And while it's ending, Ambrose is saying, this is all, he says to Jane, I know this must be hard to watch. No salvation till he passed through the minds of Jonah, though, is there, which must be a reference to, you know, spinner lore. I'm going to call it lore.
Luckily, because Ambrose is a huge bitch and I hate that guy, I yeah. specifically went out of my way to not note anytime he has anything to say because I just wrote, he says a whole bunch of bullshit that I don't care about because fuck that guy.
Well, that's why I'm here, because he says it's all part of Mother's plan for us. I've seen it and it's glorious. And we all know that Mother is, of course, the goddess.
And unfortunately for me in this specific situation, issue 5 starts with more of him prattling on about a bunch of stuff that I don't fucking care about.
He does prattle on in this. This is them fighting their way out of the colony, right? And he's,
yeah, he does it over a montage of the rest of them fighting their way out of the mine. Yeah. Right.
He says, "You really think God made you in her image? Why? Because you made us that way. Such an archaic notion." Just talking about synthetics, right? Made by humans. But like, I mean, we were made by the engineers. We were made in their image. Duh.
Also, Neal, I would like to very briefly send you a screenshot of part of my notes for this section of the comic.
All right. Fuck you. I'm going to read your note to the people.
And I just want to clarify, I did not add that now. I wrote that in my notes when I was originally taking these notes.
Kenny's notes say these are written as if he's going to read, like, dictate from these. Once again, some bullshit that doesn't matter, surely in reference to what Ambrose was saying. Luckily, yep. I don't need to tell you what it is because I'm sure Neal is going to tell you all about it.
That is correct. I literally wrote in my notes, I was like, I not only do I not want to talk about what he says, I don't even need to, because even if I skip over it entirely, Neil's going to insist that we do. So yeah. I'm not even going to bother saying what he's talking about.
Look, whether like this goddess, this mother stuff, like, did it work out super well in the end now that we've put all the pieces together? I'm not sure. Right. I do still think it's an interesting idea. And I don't know, I think it's kind of fun to talk about, right?
I just want to clarify, the reason why I didn't care and didn't bother writing it down or any of that is not because he was talking about Mother. It's because I just don't give a shit about what Ambrose has to say.
Yeah,
because I don't like him as a character.
I don't like him either. I still don't understand how he's talking. He doesn't have a mouth anymore. He's like the middle section of a head.
Yeah.
And that's it. But anyway, they all do manage to escape, right? As Ambrose says, Spinner Doctrine says that anyone who takes Mother into their heart is transformed and that they become Mother herself. That sounds a lot like what happens in Icarus. Thank you very much.
They all pile back onto that APC. And then during this conversation, Simon, for the first and not only time, finally publicly acknowledges that the woman he saved might not actually be the Sophie he was looking for.
He's also like saying we can't leave Tabby behind, and Old Man Rivers, like, Tabby's gone. And yeah, and he's like, I don't know, like, if this is Sophie or not. But there's a tension here, right? Because Old Man River's going to be like, Tabby would be here. Actually, he's about to say it as they're driving through the night. He says Tabby would be alive now if Simon hadn't ran into that mine. And then Jane's like, well, yeah, but this woman wouldn't be if he had, So there's some interesting commentaries there, right? Like trading one life for another, I liked Tabby, though. She was good people.
Yeah, she was fine. I mean, yeah. I didn't really have any strong opinions about her either way. The main thing I remember about her is that she's the one that called Becca a whore in like issue 2 or whatever.
Becca was fraternizing with her husband.
Okay, I didn't say necessarily that it was or wasn't justified. I just said that was the main thing I remember about her.
Right, fair. Okay.
So after they're driving through the night for a little while longer.
By fraternizing, I mean they were fucking.
Yes, they were having sex. That's correct.
Yeah.
After that, there is another montage of them like traveling overland this time, and they finally make it to Gamma Station. And just as they approach Gamma Station through like the tall fields around it, wouldn't you know it, a whole bunch of xenomorphs come out of the fields.
This is, again, yeah, they had to ditch the truck at some point and do like cross water and like climb like a rock or something. And then they're like crawling through these wheat fields, and you see the atmosphere processor in the background, and you see some more industrial like silos and things like that in front of it.
Yeah, like I said, they made it to Gamma Station. Yeah.
I know. I'm describing this because I like this artwork, too. This is also good artwork. And then you see these tails just go up right in the wheat field. And it's pretty badass looking. Like, it's a cool scene. It is very reminiscent of Covenant. when we, but that was like at nighttime, and that was just the little bloodbursters like charging through, like to see like these, this is kind of reminding me, you just watched the Jurassic Park movies, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, like the raptors in the field in Lost World.
Sure do.
Yeah, man. It's like that. And that's a cool scene. That's the good, that's the good part of that movie.
It's one of a few good parts.
Yeah, actually, I actually like that movie quite a bit.
I mean, I'm not absolutely in love with it, and the first one is definitely better. Like, as a matter of fact, since we're talking about it, I'll even make a bold stance and go on record right now and say that I think Lost World is the worst of the original trilogy.
Yeah, I feel like that's happened now. Like, public opinion on Jurassic Park 3 has changed.
It's a good movie, man. It's fun.
Yeah, I have told this story before places, probably. Maybe just privately, maybe not on a podcast. I had a flight from like San Francisco back to Florida or vice versa.
Mm-hmm.
Sometime like when Jurassic Park was playing on airplanes, okay? Mm-hmm. And I alternated for the entire flight. I alternated Jurassic Park 3 and the first Tomb Raider movie.
Like the Angelina Jolie one.
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
Yeah. So I would just watch one and then the other and then the other and then the other. So I watched, that's a lot of watching Jurassic Park 3 in one day, you know?
And I mean, it's more times than I've ever watched Jurassic Park 3 in one day.
Yeah. And so like,
I believe my record for that is one time, by the way.
That's most people's record. I watched Jurassic Park 3 in total, I think, 3 times that day,
nice.
All within like pretty quick succession of each other, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, that's going to color my opinion of the film. That the pterodactyl scene fucking rules, but that's about it.
It's so good, like, dog.
The rest of the movie, I don't care. But like, that pterodactyl scene fucking rules.
There's two moments in the movie. I can't believe we're talking about this. We're not here to talk about this. So I'm just going to say this real quick. Well, we're already in the middle of this conversation. So I just want, since we were already talking about good scenes in this movie, there are two scenes in Jurassic Park 3 that I think legitimately deserve to be considered as iconic, as the iconic moments from the first one.
Okay.
They are the moment where the pterodactyl walks out of the fog towards them on the bridge. And there is the scene near the end of the movie where the Spinosaurus is trying to kill William H. Macy and Sam Neill lights the river on fire.
Yeah, dude. Yeah.
I think those two scenes are like legitimately like iconic moments of cinema
and
that are unfortunately in this movie because that movie was not nearly as popular as the other ones. So it's not like as well known as the other ones, you know?
All right. Yeah. Three scenes, though, because you're forgetting about the part where Alan Grant wakes up or dreams on the airplane and that a raptor is talking to him.
That's fine. Everyone gives that moment shit. It's fine.
Alan.
I don't have any problems with it. It's totally fine. Totally reasonable. And it makes sense in context.
It's a dream. I'm just.
Yeah, he's having a nightmare about the thing that almost killed him. It's reasonable.
It's totally reasonable. It's totally fine.
Anyway,
Lost World would have been a better movie if they hadn't cut the pterodactyl scene from that movie that was planned, because it's the only way that the boat making it back with everybody dead on board makes sense, right? Because when they brought the T-Rex to San Diego, I think it was San Diego.
Yeah, it was.
Everyone on board is dead,
mm-hmm.
and you don't know how or why. And like the implication is that the T-Rex did it, but the T-Rex was still like locked in the cargo bay.
Mm-hmm.
So it just doesn't work without that. Like a script had the pterodactyls had swarmed and killed everybody on board.
I mean, I'll say, though, that I am ultimately glad that scene's not in the second one, because if it was in the second one, it wouldn't have been in the third one. And that means the third one would have only had one really good scene rather than two.
Or would it have been like even better in the third one, because it would have been like a callback at that point. Right.
Fair enough.
Would have been like, oh shit, pterodactyls. We know it's bad news when they show up. They eat everybody. Anyway.
They sure do. Like you said, they arrive to Gamma Station and there's a whole bunch of xenomorphs in the fields that start to attack them. Jane chases everyone away to the station and she stays behind to hold off the xenomorphs when one of them leaps out from the field to attack her and then immediately gets fucking obliterated by automatic weapons fire.
Yeah, two of them actually
just blown into fucking pieces.
Yeah, it's pretty rad.
And then we learn
it's a man named Gregory.
Yep. And we find out 5 issues into the 6-issue arc, we finally find out the main character's last name. Jane's last name is Callan, C-A-L-L-A-N. Yeah. It's only said one time ever in the entire run of this comic right now.
Jane Callan, you haven't aged a day, which is funny. Because weren't there a bunch of jokes in the first issue of this about how old she was, even though how she doesn't look old? She is, yeah. And also, she's dying of this illness, right?
She sure is.
It's causing her to have mobility issues, and this guy's like, you haven't aged a day, right?
But like you said, this guy's name is Gregory. He is the leader of Gamma Station, which, of course, Jane would already know.
Yeah, I'll tell you, I got a good feeling about this guy.
You should. And Jane and Gregory pick up the rest of the survivors. And as he's leading them around Gamma Station, he says that he lets them know that a second ship full of UA troops landed not too long after and rescued most of the people on station. And him and a handful of people stayed behind just to, like, you know, pick up stragglers or latecomers or like other survivors, you know.
And we do see other soldiers with him. Right. So. Mm-hmm. Also, is he intentionally kind of dressed like Han Solo in this, or is that coincidence?
I didn't notice, so I have to assume it's a coincidence, because if it was a reference, it was subtle enough that I didn't even notice it. So,
okay.
But Gregory stops for a moment and quotes scripture to her, which is relevant due to what's about to happen.
He's literally walking around like, hey, where's Ambrose? I like that guy. Right.
Yeah.
He's a good guy.
He stops and quotes scripture
as the lost. I'm going to quote it. You know, it's in your notes that I'm going to do this.
I actually didn't. The one point that I screenshotted was the only time I was like, Neal has something to say here about this. So
he says, as the lost put their trust in the things that they themselves have made, you will know your brothers and sisters as they who trust in me. And Jane's like, yeah.
She's like, that's weird. That's not actually correct. And that is a misprint that Ambrose used to quote all the time, because him being a synth had the original version of the book. And now you do, too.
Right.
And then she immediately pulls out a knife and slashes him with it.
Well, she slashes him first. And everyone's like, what the fuck are you doing? And she goes on and she's like, you just quoted Ambrose's favorite passage. And what's funny is that that isn't how it's written in the book. So I'm thinking that Ambrose, being a synth, had the mistaken version uploaded into his memory banks, and I'm betting you do too. So show me your arm, and if you bleed red, we're all good, right? And we're going to go with you.
And then he doesn't do that and instead puts all of them under arrest.
I thought that this was a very fun twist. He doesn't just put them under arrest. He shoots Old Man River. He shoots what did you say his name was? Bowie.
Bowie.
Yeah, shoots him good. I thought this was a clever sort of reveal, like that she would know the passage so well that she would know a typo, and like that this would be a passage that Ambrose quoted all the time. It just happened, and she even says, like, I felt rude correcting him, you know. But, like, she's put all these pieces together since then. Like, I thought it was interesting, a little bit of writing here. That would be how she figures out that this guy's a synth, you know?
What I thought was actually a pretty clever twist was the fact that they did a second synth surprise in this comic.
You're right. I gotta add him to the list.
Almost every like piece of alien media has like a surprise. This character is actually a synth, and like this one did it too. But I did not see coming the fact that they would do it a second time, like 2 issues later.
It's true. Gregory.
So anyway, he captures them and then leads them down into some like hallway room down underneath in the bowels of the station.
Our first G, and by the way.
And he locks them in a room filled with a whole bunch of bodies and face huggers.
Whole bunch of Oros.
And then while they're standing there, Bowie gets face hugged. And like you said, he was the guy that got shot. And as he's like lying on the ground being face hugged, we get VO in text boxes of Jane suddenly out of nowhere starting to actually pray.
Yeah. And it's weird because that's how that's how the issue ends. It's her like praying in these red text boxes while she's screaming that she's going to kill Gregory, right?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Right when we pick up in issue 12, she's now praying in regular speech bubbles, and the red is her internal monologue asking, is she praying? Why is she still praying? So like it switches from like internal to external. Kind of a cool device, honestly. Like once I talked, like it was confusing to me at first, but now that I've talked it out, it's like, oh no. She's just no longer praying inside. She's praying out loud, and her subconscious or her conscious mind is processing everything. But we're in issue 12 now. Issue 12 cover, by the way, sick as hell. Facehuggers on everyone except one crawling onto her, right?
If everyone, I cannot remember what the album of it is or what the name of it is, but there is a very famous Queen album cover that looks a lot like this.
Yeah. And Mountain Dew commercial also.
I don't remember which Queen album it is, but it's the one where it's just like the four of them, their heads are in like a diamond formation. This looks like that, except three of them have a face hugger, and the fourth one on the bottom is Jane trying to force a face hugger from not latching onto her. Also, because I said that I would do it if it happened at all this issue, Metal Clergy showed up in the comments for issue 11.
It is Queen 2.
Queen 2. Okay.
Metal Clergy is back.
He doesn't really say anything really important this time. He just says, despite the chores of writing action, and action is capitalized, PKJ has managed to surprise me with this issue of Alien. That said, I still look forward to a new creative team.
Interesting. I forget.
That's all he has to say. He didn't get any replies. He didn't get any thumbs up or thumbs down. Nobody shared it. No hearts, no nothing. He just said that into the void and never got a response.
How was he? Which one was he? Was he the one down on the previous issues?
Yes.
Okay. That tracks then. So I'm glad that this one sort of won him over a little bit.
Worked for him. Right. Yeah.
That's good.
And also, just so everyone knows, he was not on the previous issue. And unfortunately, he will not be in the comments on the next issue. So this is his only appearance in this episode.
Well, we're on issue. Oh, that was his comment for issue 11 then.
Yes.
Because we're on to issue 12 now.
And that's the only comment he left in this episode. So.
Gotcha. I understand.
Like you said, issue 12 starts with her praying some more. And while she's doing that, she suddenly has the conscious realization that the reason the face huggers are not going after her is because her disease makes her an unfit host for them.
Yeah.
And so she uses her ability to not get attacked by them to rally all the other survivors to just find weapons and start beating the shit out of all these tuber Xenos.
Yeah, she like literally goes for the face huggers. She's like literally just grabbing them herself because she's safe to grab them because they won't infect them. Because we did see that in the first half. I didn't touch on it on my sloppy summary that one did attempt to face hug her, but then left. And I was speculating like, oh, that's interesting. What if she got implanted and that's going to be a problem on this half of the story arc, right? But no, she just wasn't implanted at all because she's sick. We picked up weeks later. Like, what you were saying was absolutely correct.
That she and just wasn't she a has that host. Realization. Yeah, she has that realization herself here in the comic.
Yeah.
And speaking of realizations, they also discover that when you hit a xenomorph and it bleeds, the acid will eat through the floor. And so she tells everyone to pick up weapons and just start clubbing xenos to make enough of them bleed to create a hole in the ground that they can escape through.
Yeah. So they like rip. It's I think Old Man River. bit it. Now he got face hugged, right?
He did. He get face hugged, but a whole bunch of tuber Xenos jumped on him and started eating him, and then he died. Yeah.
That's gnarly. But Simon and presumably Sophie, is that her name?
And assuming it is Sophie, yes.
And
Leo. Jane and Leo, yeah.
Yeah, they all grab, they start like literally ripping pipes off the wall, which starts causing water to flood in as well. And they start beating the shit out of these little Xenos. And this is a hive there doesn't seem to be any full-size ones in here, right? These are just the tuber Xenos and face huggers that implant tuber Xenos.
As far as I know, that's correct.
That actually does get confirmed later in a couple pages here. Because as they are beating the shit out of the Xenos, we see a ship land to talk to
Gregory.
It's a man named Dr. Palmer, right?
And yeah, there is a Dr. Palmer, and there's someone referred to as a Sergeant Major, who we later find out his name is Rodinsky, and they are from, I believe they're from UA, if I recall.
No, they're Weyland-Yutani.
Oh, okay. I thought somebody said they were from UA.
But that was the excuse. That was what Gregory told her, that there was some UA ship arrived with soldiers, but this is the company, though. It was actually the company.
Now that I say that out loud, I was like, yes, that does make more sense.
Yeah.
But they show up, and Gregory leads them to where the survivors were, you know, the now surely implanted hosts are.
Right.
And they open the door, and everyone is, let's say, nonplussed when they find out that all the survivors escaped.
There's some interesting dialogue here. Like, Gregory, I think, is asking if there's any word on how the UA is going to react to this move by the company, because they invested so much money on Euridice. And whoever answering him is like, the UA is not going to do shit, not publicly. Nobody cares about a rock on the outer rim, much less a few hundred spinners, right? Mm-hmm. I do want to touch on some of the political company aspects of this whole thing when we get there. But yeah, they open the door and they just see Bowie's body and a bunch of water flooding out through a hole in the floor that's still kind of burning with acid. Mm-hmm. And they're like, ah, shit, we have a breach. There's aliens loose in the compound. And Gregory's like, all right, fine, I'll do it myself, right? Cocks a gun. And he's like, I'm a synth, I'm going to go down there.
Yeah, Gregory goes down to look for the survivors while all of the other soldiers are like, we got to get out of here. And as they're running away, they get ambushed by a bunch of Xenomorphs.
Right. He's basically like, get fucked, pussies. I'm going down for the real fight.
And a bunch of the soldiers get killed while Gregory heads down the hole.
Yeah. And he's calling out to Jane. He's saying he knows about her disease. He's like, I don't know how you survive these things. He realizes, oh shit, they opened a door and let a big Xenomorph in, right?
And just as he realizes that, his arm gets fucking blown off by a shotgun.
Yeah. Well, once he radios back to the Weyland-Yutani soldiers to let them know that there's some big aliens. But they're not answering the radio comm because they're getting murdered by those big aliens.
That's correct, yes.
Yeah. Fun shots. This has the same sort of problem as some of these other ones, where people either look sort of cut and pasted on top of a background, or but the panels where everything is reduced to like a silhouette with like these muzzle flashes and stuff look pretty cool. You know, it's a combination of art that really works for me and art that doesn't work for me at all on these pages of Carnage.
And I believe Jane is the one with the shotgun.
No, it's your boy Simon. Simon shot his arm off. Simon's holding a gun, and presumably Sophie is holding a pistol at him. And Jane's like, don't pick up your gun from your other arm, or we're going to shoot your other arm off too, right?
She leads him out and up to the Weyland-Yutani ship the soldiers left behind. And then we find out that Jane used to be a pilot that worked for Weyland-Yutani. So that's fun.
She also told Gregory that the Xenomorphs won't touch her because of her illness.
I don't remember her saying that, but sure.
She does. It does come back. That's why I'm bringing it up. When he's down there, he's like, I don't know how you survived these things. And she says, turns out the aliens don't like this disease that's killing me any better than I do. So then she's like, take us to the ship. Right.
Yeah. And then we get an absolutely yet another phenomenal shot of gore when Jane blows the bottom half of Gregory's head off.
She does. It's pretty gnarly.
And the top half like pops up like a broken Pez dispenser. It rules.
To circle back to what you brought up, Leo's story about the church. This is where Jane asks, did the company create the church? Was this all just a giant con, right? And was the Church of the Spinners just invented by the company? And Gregory implies that he has the answer. He says, part of me really wants to tell you the answer to that, but I know how much that question's been eating you, so I think I'll keep you in suspense.
Mm-hmm.
Boom. She shotguns his neck off, right? She like removes his neck. Is what she does.
Yeah, it's like collar blade to like nose, right around there. That entire area just gets removed from his body. It deleted. Rules. Yeah.
And then, oh, it's Leo's the one who said he could fly, because she's like, can you really fly this thing, Leo? And he's like, I don't know, sort of. Let's plug Ambrose into it and see if that gets us anywhere, right?
And then following up on something that I wrote in my notes but did not say on the episode, earlier on, when all those soldiers were getting killed by the Xenos, I even wrote in my notes, a whole bunch of the soldiers are getting killed here, but I don't know if this is meant to imply that all of them got killed or that only some of them did. We find out the answer here when some of them come out of the building and try to be like, hey, wait for us, let us get on the ship. And Jane's like, get fucked, before she flies away.
Get fucked, nerds. And then they fly off. Yeah, all the forgiveness has been bled right out of me, Leo. Holy smokes.
And she leaves him behind as they fly away. Ambrose gives another speech about like the Xenos and stuff.
Yeah, I won't read it here, but it's more, this is a paradise for mother's children, right?
I think he's talking some more about mother and stuff, but sure. Yeah. All right. Cool, dude.
We all do mother's will with every thought and act, and she still has a plan for each of you.
And then there is what my brain kind of registered as like almost a post-credit scene, even though it's just the end of the book. It's not after the credits. It's just the ending. But my brain still registered it as more of an epilogue than an actual ending. But it cuts to like a Weyland-Yutani station just somewhere else.
Yep.
And
Weyland-Yutani Earth Orbital Station Reynolds.
And some dudes are standing around looking at a computer, and they get a message about how the spinners have like taken over this WY ship and are like piloting it back towards Earth. Then this guy shows up that looks like halfway between Lance Henriksen and Peter Cushing.
Yeah.
And he's looking at the message and he says, huh, it says here that somebody has some kind of disease that prevents them from getting infected by face huggers. Well, 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 maybe that's worth some more looking into. And then the comic ends.
End of chapter 2. Yeah, the cipher came in, presumably from Gregory, right? Actually, it's probably from Ambrose, because Ambrose is plugged into the ship that they're tracking, right?
So yeah, I had assumed it was Ambrose because he was also there, but I mean, it could have been Gregory because he probably was also in contact with them.
I think you're probably right, and it was Ambrose. That makes sense. And this guy does, depending on the panel, look a lot like Lance Henriksen. I'm thinking it's coincidence. I'm thinking.
Yeah, I think it's just supposed to be some guy. I don't think it's supposed to be like be a bishop or whatever.
So what's interesting is that the orbital station is called the Reynolds, and Ted Reynolds was the guy in charge of Epsilon Station. So it makes me wonder if this has been like named in his honor or
it was named after him. Yeah.
Yeah. Maybe this is the new Epsilon Station. This is where they're doing the bioweapon stuff now, because obviously like this was their first big bioweapon test. I think the general was saying that, like, really glad we got to do our bioweapons test. We can't release these things on Earth. It would be chaos, but this was like the perfect setting for it.
The only other thing of note, as far as like plot developments from previous issues that I had, because like I mentioned, that's the end of this issue. And so therefore the end of the arc. The only other, like, plot hook, plot twist, plot thread, whatever you want to call it, yeah, that's like kind of left dangling and not really given answers by the time the end of it is, we never do find out if that girl actually was Sophie or not.
Yeah. Jane asks Simon how he's doing. He says, I don't know what she saw down in that mine or the things I saw. Do you think she's really Sophie? And Jane says, I don't know, Simon, but you went in there when none of us would have. She's alive because of you, and that's a powerful thing. Yeah, we don't get an answer to if that's Sophie or not. Yeah. And like, we see her holding a gun, like holding Gregory at gunpoint, right, with Simon. But she never speaks a word. She's just kind of like, I don't know. I don't even see her, like, yeah, in the main cockpit of the ship with everybody. Like, she must be
the only line of dialogue pretty much that she has in the entire book. Okay, assuming she's not Sophie, the only line of dialogue she has in the entire book is she goes, when Simon pulls her out of the resin. If it is Sophie, then she has two lines, that one and the one from issue one, right, where Simon is talking to her on the radio and she's like, you got it, Simon, Sophie, yeah, here, or whatever she says. And right, that's it.
She says red, yellow, yellow, green, blue, yellow.
That's correct.
That's a Simon the Game joke.
I got it. Don't worry.
Yeah, man. We talked about the first half of this for like 2 hours, and some of that was bullshitting, yeah, right? Like, mm-hmm, 20 minutes or so, maybe. This second half flew by fast. A lot more happened in it, but it was all pretty, yep, straightforward, right? It was, I mean, aside, yep, from the twist of the second synthetic.
Yeah, there were a lot of things that happened, but the stuff that happened took up like big chunks of the books they were in, yeah, so a lot of big things happen, but only a couple things like happened per issue, you know.
Yeah. Oh, here's something fun. When the general touches down, or the doctor, Dr. Palmer, touches down, he specifically says, have you found hosts for the arthropod hybrids yet? So they're now that they've unleashed like the xenomorph on the planet and it's created native versions, they're now down here hoping to get samples of those hybrids, mm-hmm, to use for, again, further weaponization or further research or something. And I feel like that's something I haven't really seen before. Like, I know, I probably referenced this before. I think Cold Forge, the xenomorphs hatched out of primates in that one. So like,
I haven't read it, so I couldn't tell you.
I mean, we have examples of this, and we have examples, I think, in Infiltrator too. They have, you know, there's various xenomorphs that have hatched out of like native species. That's the novel that ties into Fireteam. But this is it's very fun that like they have this specific hive of arthropod, like hybrid xenomorphs. Mm-hmm. And they're like, let's get some samples from these arthropod hybrids. Like, let's take these back and see what else we can do with them. I don't know. It's just fun. They're just like cataloging these different variations and stuff. We've talked about this before. It's fun when we see a non-standard xenomorph, right?
It sure is, baby. Yeah. I love it.
We see lots of XX121s, etc., right? It is very fun to see a non-standard xenomorph. We got that with Alpha, right? Mm-hmm. Sort of that weird goat hybrid one, you know? Mm-hmm. And now we got these guys, and we got the weird fish scale one in Thaw, right? And then the human hybrid in Icarus. We've been getting a lot of hybrids in these Marvel books.
Don't get me wrong, I'm never going to get tired of seeing a regular xenomorph, because like, those guys are the reason I'm here.
Yeah.
So I will never be like, oh, another regular xenomorph. I will always be thrilled to see those guys. But right, it's cool they mix it up, you know?
Yeah, it's fun.
Yeah.
Yeah. If like, where was I? I was at a local place called Retro Rat. Mm-hmm. It's the store that sells... they got comics. They got a whole bunch of vintage like Star Wars and G.I. Joe toys and things like that, and alien toys and stuff. They had two of the same alien figure. It's the Burster, right? You, mm-hmm, see in Fireteam, you see the Burster. One of them was in the Aliens Fireteam Elite box. One of them was in a different box, like a different Aliens box from a different toy line, right? Mm-hmm. But it was the same figure in the same Burster, right? So some of these variations, like there's the standard variations that you do kind of see over and over again. Certain ones pop up in the toy lines. Like, I know the new like the new version of the classic Kenner toy line features a lot of the same ones of like the Jaguar alien and the Rhino mm-hmm. alien. And, you know, that's all fun, but like in books, in games and stuff, we get these kind of standard sort of runner, warrior, drone, spitter, burster, and then some pathogen variations and stuff in fire team and, you know, maybe specific ones here and there. But I want to see shit like this start popping up. Like, I want to see these fucking dudes running around, these little arthropod tuber morphs or whatever. Mm-hmm. You know, I want to see those alpha looking goat things jumping around. I don't know, man. Like, fucking go for it, right? Like,
yeah, no reason not to, you know.
No reason not to, right? Especially in a post Alien Covenant world.
That's right.
All right. So I don't know that I have anything else I want to talk about too much in this, except, you know, I thematically I think this is a really interesting story. Again, the rejection of technology versus living in the shadow of it versus, you know, being used by the corporation, like the very thing, entity that you feared, you ended up getting in bed with to try to gain your freedom, and then you were just used as well. Mm-hmm. Like, there's a lot of themes in this book, right?
There sure are.
No shortage of themes in this. Yeah. And overall, I think it all works really well. I can't help but think here at the end, this group of people with this synthetic head, these religious people who had rejected technology, now flying away in a spaceship. I mean, the last issue opened with her like still praying and wondering why she's praying. And then she's questioning her faith so bad, she asks the android if it was made up or not. He doesn't answer, but she's still like questioning it, right? So like, are we to believe that she really has given up everything she believed in? Or I guess I'm asking, like, is this a book about somebody losing their faith?
I am of the belief that she already had. Like, it's not her questioning. She is right. Straight up a non-believer.
Yeah, because even at the end, she's like, you know, I'm all the forgiveness has been bled right out of me.
And like earlier on when she was praying, she even says, I haven't done this in years because, like, what's the point? Or I don't remember exactly what she says, but she even says, I literally don't know why I'm praying right now. I haven't done this in years. This isn't something I do or even care about anymore. Right. And like that coupled with the fact earlier on in the issues of her talking about like how, oh yeah, I came here to be part of the spinners. And like the moment I was diagnosed, I was like, I am absolutely willing to get out of here and leave them and go do this other thing. And the only reason I'm staying behind is because they're relying on me. Like, yeah. all that kind of stuff put together tells me that she's probably not even questioning her faith. She right. probably literally doesn't have it anymore.
Cause she was dealing with if, like she couldn't get the treatment that will absolve her of this illness because we presume it's something technology based that she's not allowed yeah. to use as a spinner. But she was doing this for everybody else. Right. Yeah. But she made multiple references in this to like saving the last four people of her flock, yeah. you know? So it seems like she's really on the fence, but I guess by the end of this, and maybe with the combination of Ambrose telling her like, no, this is what our religion, like all of the stuff that is happening is what was prophesized to happen. She's just, I guess, yeah, she's just fucking done with it. You're right.
Yeah, like basically the gist is Ambrose basically just keeps on going, look, this isn't for you, okay? Yeah. And then finally by the end of it, she's like, okay, fine.
Yeah. I didn't ask you the question after every single issue this time, but just generally, I think it's probably safe to say that had we read issues, you know, each of these independently, it would have made us pick the next issue up, right?
Yeah, I mean, yeah. It's one of those things where, like, to be honest, like, you know, as you mentioned, I also didn't really realize you hadn't been asking, but that's fine because the answer just straight would have been yes the entire time.
Yeah. Now,
that was fine.
Now, here's the question. Had you finished this story arc, ended chapter two, would you have been excited to pick up the next Alien story? Would you have been, like, excited to pick up the Alien Annual?
Well, the Alien Annual, probably not.
Yeah.
But like the next arc, maybe. Because like the thing of it is that the, you know, Bloodlines and this are billed as part one and part two of like an individual storyline.
Right.
But like to me, there's only like vague thematic connecting threads between them. It's not part one and part two of a story, you know?
Right.
And so that combined with the fact that this comic ends on like not really a cliffhanger, but like introducing like a new thing for the plot to develop in that direction of this way you guy going, we're going to have to look into this chick. And then as it turns out, that never goes anywhere or gets followed up on at all. And the next arc is just something completely unrelated to what's been happening so far.
Right.
Like,
well,
if I had known all that going in, I probably wouldn't have picked up the next arc, you know?
Sure. But the next arc would, the full next full arc is Icarus, which is dope. And
yeah. And I, and that's the thing. I wouldn't have picked it up. And then after the fact found out that I fucking missed out.
And extremely like thematically, you know, connected still. Sorry, I'm looking at the end, the last pages of Icarus. I'm just gonna see if there's something poetic, because that really, like, we just finished the middle chapter, right, of a planned,
sure did,
of a planned three chapter story by Philip Kennedy Johnson, all dealing with this concept of the goddess, of the mother, whatever you want to call it, that we saw sort of culminate in this combination of human pathogen and xenomorph in the Icarus storyline, right?
Yeah, and we took the extremely smart approach of not talking about them in order.
Right.
So
if you haven't listened to those or read those issues, you absolutely should. God, Icarus, first of all, fantastic looking book. I'm really just looking through this again. I'm like, this is a fun looking book. This ended with a monologue, right? A given, again, tabbing into this sort of religious idea, right? This ended with Eli reading, reciting a passage from the books of David, the teachings of David, right? Mm-hmm. I'm going to read this just to see if this adds any sort of thematic weight to all of this mother talk, now that we've seen like the whole thing. When at last they are gone, humanity will leave behind two gifts to the universe, precious in equal measure: our creation and their self-destruction. More than any other trait, man is defined by his inexorable, inevitable attraction to the flame, his childlike need to touch it with no thought of consequence. The brighter and more destructive that flame, the more fiercely it calls to him. And the brightest flames have always been the stars. Since the first man raised his eyes to the night sky, his destruction has called out to him, seducing him from the blackness of space. She patiently awaits his answer, a glittering corpse in the dark, and that answer is inevitable. So this is, again, just this idea of, like, mankind is going to destroy itself, like, through all of this, right? And it's going to, like, become something else. Does that give you any more feelings about any of this, Kenny? Having heard that from the teachings of David,
I still think the concept of the mother and the goddess is just dumb in this book. Like, it doesn't make me like the idea anymore, but it does make me understand what Philip Kennedy Johnson was going for, because like how I said that, like, the plots of part one and part two aren't really connected, just like the plots of part two and part three aren't connected, but they have like that one, like, not really religious link, but like they have that one thematic through line,
right,
of just like the mother being brought up and the concept of what it is slowly being developed over the course of the three arcs. And well, it's like, had I read those three arcs in the sequence they were written and intended to be read in, would I feel any differently about it? Probably not. But it would have also, it would have at the very least enabled me to understand what he was going for better by taking them in the intended order, you know?
Right. Yeah. I think that, I mean, the fact that this story is told over three distinct storylines and groups of people and eras, right? I think the idea is that it's just an inevitable universal truth, right? You kind of, you know, like, there's like a lot of overlap. If we were just going to talk about like specific like religions and things, there's a lot of like thematic overlap, right? Like, various religions have a flood story, you know, various, like, there's just things that happen, right? And I think that the idea is, you know, this is the common thread. This is just like an undeniable truth of the future and of humanity. It's very Lovecraftian, really. It's like we went out in the stars. We found something we weren't supposed to find. We tried to exploit it for our own gain, and we ended up becoming a part of this thing, right? Like, this thing consumed us, basically.
Which I would like to point out is also the plot of Mass Effect 1.
Okay. Mass Effect 1 episode coming up next.
I mean, pretty much. It's like, instead of the Xenomorphs, well, instead of, I guess... Yeah, I suppose it would be. I'm trying to figure out who's who in this simile here.
Yeah.
But basically the gist of it is that humanity discovers the Citadel where like other like species are. And they're like, we should take advantage of this. And then when they do, they eventually find out that the Citadel was created millions and millions of years ago by this like techno-organic race of monsters. And they specifically created it basically to like keep an eye on the various species around the universe. Okay. And like when one of them gets too technologically advanced, they use the Citadel, which is like basically a portal creator, to arrive in the galaxy and then eradicate everything. Okay. And like even how it was mentioned, I believe it was in this comic. Yeah, it was in, or it wasn't in this comic. It was in Bloodline. Sorry, about how Iris was talking about like how, oh, do you honestly think that humanity is like the first species to discover this?
Right.
That's also even a plot point in Mass Effect where, you know, every 50,000 years or so, a species will finally get technologically advanced enough to like activate the thing that summons the Reapers. Okay. And so this is like a cycle that has happened hundreds and hundreds and isn't hundreds this, of times, you
isn't
know,
this also what the Flood is in the Halo universe.
That I don't know, because of the two people on this call, I'm not the one that's an Xbox guy. So I don't know. I've never played Halo. I don't know.
I'm pretty sure it's the same sort of thing. There's these, I'm not deep on Halo lore. Call me an Xbox guy. I've played the first two Halos and part of the third one, and that's it. So, and then like, I don't know. I played like 20 minutes of Halo Infinite.
Also, I suppose I should say a spoiler alert for Mass Effect 1. But yeah. That game came out in 2007. So if you haven't played it by now, I guess you're out of luck.
Yeah, man, and I was just getting ready to play it on my Xbox with Game Pass because I'm an Xbox guy.
Well, here's the thing. You should, because Mass Effect is actually really good.
I'm playing Yakuza 0.
I'm playing Yakuza, as well, and you should be, baby.
And Starfield and Mortal Kombat 1.
Which I'm also playing MK1, yes. We didn't talk about it at the top of the episode, but I have beaten the storyline of Mortal Kombat 1. And I'm currently playing through invasions mode.
Yeah.
And man, it's so long, dog.
Invasions mode?
It's so long.
Here's the thing. When I got Mortal Kombat 1, I ripped through story mode. And then I played a little bit of invasions. I think I got through all of Johnny's. And then I played like three towers. And then I just played more Starfield. Like, don't get me wrong. Like, Mortal Kombat 1 is awesome. And I love it. Yeah. But I haven't had a whole lot of time to play games, and so I've been playing some Starfield.
It was one of those things where I was playing through all the MK games just so I could like get through the story, and then after I was all caught up, I was gonna go back to the games I had been playing. But then I started playing MK1 and I was like, oh no, this game's actually really good. Because like, here's the thing, I fucking hate fighting games.
Except Mortal Kombat.
Mortal Kombat and Injustice are the only fighting games I play, and both of them are made by the same company. So,
and it's because of those narrative story modes.
Yeah, it's
right?
Because like, of the story.
That is why I play Mortal Kombat and Injustice also. I play other fighting games too. I don't do like online fighting. Sarah likes to kick my ass at Tekken on occasion. Mm-hmm. I had my fighting game phase. I left it behind when, you know, it's when you don't keep up, it's not fun. So I enjoy a fighting game with a good single player or narrative element, and Mortal Kombat and Injustice check those boxes.
Yep. And because of that, I don't really need to play any other ones, because like, it's one of those things where I just don't like the mechanics of fighting games, but I'm interested enough in the story of Mortal Kombat that I'm willing to like joke through having to play the game to be able to like get the story mode. But like after I was done with the story mode, I was like, you know, these mechanics actually feel pretty good to me. And so like I went into the tutorial mode and I started going through the tutorials, and then I like picked a character and I started doing a couple of towers, one or two, and then I started doing invasions mode, and I was like, I'm not turning into a fighting game guy, but I think I'm actually turning into a Mortal Kombat 1 guy. Oh, nice. No.
Good. Someday they'll add crossplay and then we can fight each other.
And I just want to make it clear, you know, everyone that plays fighting games always has a main for like the games they play.
Sure.
And I know who my main is. I already decided on my main. I'm already playing through invasions mode as my main. And I want to make it clear that unlike most people, they pick their main by playing through all of the characters and deciding which one they like the feel of the best. I, meanwhile, picked my main by going, which character do I like the most? Just like looking at and like, you know, liking what they did in story mode and their whole vibe and stuff. What character do I think is the coolest one? And then I'm going to pick that one and play it, whether they're good or not, until I get used to them and become good at them. And so because of that, my main in Mortal Kombat 1 is my main man, Geerus, baby.
Hell yeah.
I love Geerus so much. That guy rules. When I was playing through 11, he showed up and I was like, I fucking love this guy. And then I was so fucking glad that he was in 1 as well. I was like, yes.
Wild pull to put Geerus in 1. It makes sense storyline wise, right?
It does. I was worried he wasn't going to be in it.
I don't have a main picked out. With modern Mortal Kombat games, I tend to start with Kung Lao. As a Conquest fan. No, it's a different Kung Lao than Conquest. This audience is not a Mortal Kombat audience. This is an alien audience. But I will say, I liked Kung Lao in Mortal Kombat 2. Reptile was my guy, but Kung Lao's fun to play as, so I usually start with him. I really like Reptile in this new game. I'm dabbling with Smoke a little bit too. I haven't picked a main. I probably won't. I don't think I have a main for 11 or 10 either, so... But I'm probably going to rotate through those three. You know?
I think, honestly, like, I only played through story mode of 9, 10, and 11. But of the playable characters in 11, you know, like, the only ones that I played were the ones that I, you know, played in story mode. And honestly, of all of those, I think I liked Liu Kang the best.
Yeah, he's reliable.
He is the Mario of Mortal Kombat. He's like the all-rounder that anyone can play and be good at, you know?
Sure.
And turns out he's actually real fucking good. Yeah. I also like Johnny Cage in 11 as well.
Yeah, Johnny Cage, he's gotten a lot of attention in these new games. He's been pretty good.
He sure has.
In 10, 11, and 1.
But yeah, Geerus is my boy in 1, and I'm going to keep playing as him. I love that guy so much. He rules.
Of course, my main for Mortal Kombat 10 was Xenomorph. Now we're back on topic.
Got him.
All right.
Good work.
Final thoughts on this thing, Kenny?
It's good. I like it. I think, like you said earlier, I think I will agree with you, and actually, now that I'm saying it out loud, agree with me, because I think I actually already said this earlier, that I do like the first half more.
Okay.
But because the second half had some parts where the art wasn't as good, and the ending, you're not going to know it at the time, but upon reading the third arc, the ending is kind of a non sequitur that doesn't go anywhere, that like twist at the end, you know, doesn't really mean anything, as it turns out,
right?
And
at least not yet, you know. I mean,
true.
A future writer is fair to bring back this character, of these characters. I mean, fucking Thaw is only set before these stories, or there's a few years after. I don't remember.
A few years before, I think it's like 2195. I think.
Yeah, so we could absolutely run into Jane and Leo and whoever else in the future. Better them than thank God Cruz died. We don't have to deal with his fucking face again.
But his weird, silly, pretty face. I thought the arc was good. I do think the ending generally stuck the landing, because the other arcs, there was something about the ending that I actively disliked. Whereas this one, I was just like, eh, it's fine. It's a typical ending. Nothing really stuck out to me. So I was like, oh yeah, the ending must work perfectly fine then.
Yeah, I think that this one, it did stick the landing, but because the third act was pretty fucking standard, right?
It didn't try to do anything weird, so all it has to do was land the plane.
You know? Yeah, it's just the survivors need to get to the ship before the Xenomorphs get them, and the Xenomorphs were occupied with the soldiers, so the survivors were able to get to the ship. Like,
yeah.
Yeah, it's not low stakes, right? But it was a pretty standard ending. But that doesn't mean that the storyline, I think, was standard. I think the storyline overall, like, explored things that the other Marvel books in particular haven't really explored, right?
I also liked how, I don't want to say I liked how there wasn't really a lot of Xenomorphs in this one, but, like, I like how the structure of it was that the Xenomorphs were just kind of like an omnipresent background threat, rather than than them like constantly always getting attacked and being chased and all that. They're always just like in Thaw, the latter half of Thaw, they're just always kind of around, you know?
Yes.
I did like that a lot.
Yeah. And like our group kind of got lucky that they got put in a colony of those tuber Xenomorphs, right?
Yeah.
A little easier to handle those maybe than some big chaps.
For sure.
One thing that thematically, like the religious idea in here, a different version of it, but kind of similar to Outbreak a little bit, right? Where we have the weird religious programming and the church of the, what do they call it? Like the one true.
I don't fucking remember what it's called.
I mean, yeah, that language may not even be in there, but basically like the Xenomorph was the true Messiah, right? And it made everybody want to go. And it was this weird, like, sonic, like, thing being put out, like, psychically by the queen that was captured to, like, draw people in to be victims.
Yeah.
That's the only other time I can really think of religion having a major part in the events. Like, that doesn't mean that there aren't characters. Like, I know that there's a scene in a chapel in Resurrection. We'll get there soon, but...
Yeah, I can't really think of any other ones off the top of my head either. Yeah.
I bet it's been explored, something that we haven't read or we're not thinking of.
Oh, follow up to a conversation from last episode, Covenant Origins, baby.
Oh, sure. Right. Duncan Fields and the Earth Savers, right?
Yeah.
Like really believing in these visions that he had, like that had some cult like.
Yeah, I wouldn't say it's not so much a religion, but that is kind of a cult.
No, and that is something we made a comparison to with Outbreak, right? I remember talking about that in the Covenant Origins issue, being like, I think that there's similar themes in Outbreak. So, you know, this isn't, I guess this is a new territory, but I like the idea of it specifically being a group who is like rejecting technology, so they don't have weaponry to fight back, right? Until the end when they kind of do, you know, but still have like relatively simple weapons like a bow and arrow and a shotgun and, you know.
Yeah, it did not occur to me until way, way later, like when I was taking my notes on like issue 11 or 12, I suddenly went, oh, that's why Jane is using a bow. They don't use technology. Duh, right. Of course.
It wasn't just like a Hunger Games reference. It's just
wasn't like she slapped it together because that's what she had. I was like, oh, she's choosing to because they don't use technology. Duh, right. Of course.
Because she called. She's like, anybody who has a gun, like we need your gun. And they only ended up with like five guns, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
One of them was Ambrose's shotgun. Of course, he had one because he was a company plant. But just the idea of this society is like choosing to reject technology, even living in the shadow of it, even though it's tied to their existence. Complicated issues, certainly some intentional like hypocrisy presented, right? That's going to happen whenever you're dealing with anything that is about a religion, right? The hypocrisies are going to get pointed out. But still, I think a story different enough from anything else that I've really read to feel fresh and different and interesting, right?
I also found it refreshing that Weyland Yutani was not a major presence in this comic.
Right. They just sort of, but again, like, that's the thing. Those are like Weyland Yutani brand atmosphere processors. So there is this idea of like Weyland Yutani is just
everywhere,
you know, casting a shadow over all of this. You can't, there is no escaping them. Right.
Yeah.
Again, I think that that's why some of those panels in the art were some of my favorites. It's, I mean, it's really on the nose, right? But it's still, it's an effective messaging.
Yeah, that's for sure.
So would you recommend this book to someone who was like, I feel like reading an alien comic. I haven't really read one, you know, or haven't read many. Would you recommend this one to somebody?
Yeah, I think I would. It wouldn't be like a full-throated, absolutely drop what you're doing and read it now recommendation like Icarus would be.
Right.
But yeah, I would recommend it. I think you were correct earlier in saying that, or in us saying in previous episodes that each one of these arcs gets better as they go. This is definitely better than Bloodlines. It's definitely not as good as Icarus.
Yeah. I really like this story. I don't think I would recommend it, certainly as a first read, you know?
All right. All right.
I would recommend, if we're going to talk modern comics, I think I would recommend Thaw first.
I would too. I would too.
Then I would say that you should check out Revival and Icarus, probably in that order, because again, I think that the Philip Kennedy Johnson stuff is more thematically connected than it seems on the surface.
But it's tough for me to be like, you should read Bloodlines to anyone, you know?
Yeah, I would just tell them what Bloodlines was and then be like, now read the follow-ups, you know?
Yeah.
But
luckily, since they're not actually narratively connected, it's not really that hard to be able to just tell someone to skip it.
So. Right. I think that they all work fine on their own. I do think that they work well as a series. Right. But you can also just read one. Like, you could just read this and have a complete story and be good. And you could just read Icarus and have a complete story and move on to something else, you know?
Yeah, for sure.
So. Well, that's it, I think.
Yeah, I don't think I have anything else, so.
Okay. Yeah, that's it for Alien Revival. That is it for, we have now covered every Marvel Alien comic. Oh, I guess, where would you fit Aliens Aftermath into the rankings? I'm kidding. It doesn't matter.
I mean, I could if you wanted me to.
yeah, let's do it just for fun. Let's rank the Marvel books from favorite to least favorite.
All right, I think I got my rankings.
Nice. Let's hear yours first.
All right.
Again, best to worst, or I don't like saying best to worst. Favorite to least favorite, descending order.
In my one and two spot, I have Icarus and Thaw. Although if pressed, I could also flip those positions.
Okay.
That's why I'm mentioning both of them at the same time.
Sure.
But I think I'm going to give just barely the edge to Icarus.
Okay.
Maybe. I don't know. You know, I already wrote it like this, so I'm just going to keep it like this. Icarus number one, Thaw number two.
Sure.
And then I believe I'm going to put Aftermath at number three. Cause I actually, I don't, like, to be honest, I'm not entirely sure what I said about that comic on the episode,
right.
But now looking at it, having not read it since then, I remember thinking it was pretty good and fun. And like, I really liked, like, you know, the glowing radioactive xenomorph. I think that's a really cool idea.
Yeah, it was a fun one shot and a fun tie in to Aliens, right? Going back to the Hadley's Hope Colony.
And then immediately after that, I have Revival.
Okay.
And then there's a big gap.
Sure.
And then I have Annual and Bloodlines in that order. Annual, I liked more than Bloodlines because it was shorter.
All right, so I would go again in descending order. My at the top, I am putting Thaw firmly at the top.
Mm-hmm.
I just ultimately ended up enjoying the sort of atmosphere of that book more than I did Icarus, and I think
yeah,
and I enjoyed the storytelling a little bit better too, to be honest.
And the thing of it is now that I'm thinking about it, I might actually switch my one and two and put Thaw at the first as well, because like there was a lot that I liked about Thaw, but there were some things that I didn't love about Icarus, and right. I didn't really have any major complaints about Thaw. So I think I actually am going to switch their positions.
Okay. Yeah. So
you've convinced me.
So I've got Thaw at number one. You've got it at number one with a bullet.
Yep. Yep.
Icarus is second for me. Again, that was just so much fun. Every issue, like I was so excited to read every issue of that. Then I'm going into Revival, and then I'm going to put Aftermath after Revival.
All right.
Because again, Revival was fun and or not Revival. Sorry. Aftermath was a fun one shot and had a lot of interesting ideas, but mm-hmm. it didn't really challenge anything for me or give me anything new. It just sort of like showed the lengths to which like Miss Yutani in that comic would go to yeah. like please the board or whatever. And I think that like the ideas of, because they were a terrorist organization going in, right? And or not a terrorist organization, an activist organization, or were they specifically eco-terrorists? I think they were specifically calling themselves terrorists, and there was like
in Aftermath, I don't actually remember. I don't remember anymore.
I mean, they're anti-corporate, so like I'm not saying that as a negative, right? Like,
I mean, they may have considered themselves terrorists. I don't remember. So,
yeah, that was the most interesting thing about the book, honestly. So, yeah, Aftermath is the one shot, and then I'm going the annual, and then I'm going Bloodlines, because I actually remember enjoyed the story of the annual. But yeah,
I mean, I will admit when I said that I liked the annual more because it was shorter, that was me being reductive as a joke. I mean, there are things in both of them that I liked, but like the annual is shorter. It is a little bit more interesting because of the fact that it's shorter. It has less of a chance to do stuff that I don't like. Like, you know, there's bad artwork in both of them.
Sure.
But since Bloodlines is longer, it has more bad artwork, you know, that kind of thing.
Yeah. Well, I think what I was getting at is Aftermath has an organization, you know, an anti-corporate, call them what you will, activist organization trying to take down or expose the truth about Weyland-Yutani, right? And it just does that a little bit better than the annual does, which featured the same type of organization, the Minute Hand movement taking over Nishimura Station.
I got you, yeah.
But that was just so underbaked and unexplored, right? And it was a catalyst just to make something else happen. I don't know. Fair. There's a similarity there in the two stories, and I just think I liked the Aftermath version a little bit better.
Fair enough.
Yeah, so that's my ranking.
Yeah,
I do think that there's more good than bad for these Marvel books. I know they've gotten a lot of criticism, and you know, we've touched on that a little bit. Like obviously when Disney/Marvel takes over a long running science fiction property, there's going to be a lot of retconning and resetting.
They tend to mix things up a lot. Yeah.
For someone like me, I've read plenty of Dark Horse comics, but I haven't read all of them or nearly all of them. These just still feel like entries, like comic book entries in an alien universe in general,
yeah,
as opposed to like a specific defining direction that the series absolutely has to go. And forgive me, but I feel like Thaw in particular felt like some classic alien stuff. I feel like this book did as well in a lot of ways. I'm overall fine with the Marvel run in general, and I'm excited to see what else we're going to get. We got an annual coming soon.
Yeah, I mean, I'm looking at this list here and there's, you know, like how I said that I have the first four things and then there's a big gap and then there's annual and Bloodlines, which I don't even know that I would be able to describe those as bad. I'd only be able to describe them as bad in comparison to the other ones.
Right.
But it's not like they're terrible. Like, you know, it's one of those things where, like, you know, I have a lot of problems with Marvel. I have a lot of problems with Disney. There's a lot of things they do wrong, but like,
yeah,
they know how to make stories, you know? And so there is going to be a certain level of craft inherent in these books, whether or not they actually turn out to be all that good. There's going to always be something in them that you can get out of it, you know?
Yeah, and, you know, again, I've enjoyed these. I am looking forward to digging into more of the Dark Horse series. pretty soon. But before we do that, Kenny, we have an annual coming out from Marvel Comics on October 4th, I believe. That's in that's about a week after this episode releases, give or take.
All right. All right.
So that might, we might just hold that to be our next episode.
Okay.
Why not? We're on a Marvel Comics run anyway, right?
I was looking at it earlier, and this will be the seventh episode in a row we've done about a comic book.
We might as well. So then when we actually get into the Alien Resurrection chapter, we could just sort of hit the ground running, you know, and just and not get disrupted by an annual or anything like that. So yeah, for sure. I don't know. Maybe we'll throw in a maybe it's time to start RG versus Predator 2. We'll figure that out off the air. But coming up soon here, we will be diving into Alien Resurrection. We are trying to get a friend on the show for that. We will have to schedule with them. So that'll be coming soon, though. So dust off your Alien Resurrection DVD copies. No one bought that on Blu-ray, right? Right?
I mean, I own the Alien Anthology, which has a Resurrection in it.
Oh, but that's right. You did. I own it on digital. I shouldn't really be talking shit. I don't know. Stay tuned to our social medias to see what our next episode is, or just subscribe to the show.
Yeah.
Kenny, where can people do all that stuff?
We're, as of this recording, we are still on Twitter. Our handle is at Crew Expendapod. We're on Blue Sky now. Our handle on that is Crew Expendable.
Yeah.
We're on Instagram at Crew Expendable Pod. Our website is crewexpendable.net. Our website is crewexpendable.net, and you can send us an email at mother@crewexpendable.net and subscribe to us on YouTube at youtube.com/@crewexpendable.
Yeah, shout out to our YouTube commenters. Hi to all of you. I think I'm a little bit behind on shout out. So we'll get to you guys next episode.
Yeah.
Thanks for subscribing. Thanks for listening. Thanks for watching. Subscribe in your podcast app. We have, Kenny, we have like 16 reviews on Spotify, you know, Spotify, 16 ratings on Spotify, and it's like a 4.3. So someone came in there and like dropped a 3 on us or something to like pull our average down.
Folks, that's fine. Whatever.
Folks, head over to Spotify, rate us 5 stars. Let's pull that number back up.
Yeah, I'd do it. But get this. I literally do not have a Spotify account.
I'm not surprised to hear that in the slightest.
Well, I had one, but I realized that it had been like something like 2 years since I used it. And so I flagged my account for deletion. And like a day or two ago, I got the email saying that my account had successfully been deleted. So
congratulations.
Yeah.
Yeah. Rate us and review us on the other podcast platforms. Good Pods, Apple Podcasts, all of those places. Helps the show out, helps us climb those charts, etc. Kenny, where can people find you on the internet?
Like the show, I am still currently using Twitter for now. I am also on Blue Sky and Letterboxd. My handle on all three of them is at CYHOBBEZ.
You can find me on Instagram at Final Neal Retro. You know what? You can go to finalneal.com and find links to the places I have stuff.
Oh, I'm being blown away right now.
It's just a link tree. I've had that URL for a long time though, and I just pointed it at a link tree.
Good work.
And you can find this show there. You can find my Twitch account. You can find my other podcast, MK Podquest, a show about Mortal Kombat movies, TV shows, comics, music, etc. Over there. Check that out. We will be back soon to either talk about the new Alien annual or something else.
Or something else.
Until then,
stay frosty.